trying to get everything up on top of the hill. They did require us down in back of the transfer station, further down that driveway that goes along there, to put down a small area for painted and clean wood storage area for inert fill, which is, you know, odds and ends of pieces of concrete, that type thing, as well as way down around the back, an area where we would finally really truly compost leaf and yard waste, where we'd actually have the burrows, that's not the winnows, windrows, thank you, I knew Carol would know, the windrows, I should know that, heard it a million times, the windrows, where we'd actually process that leaf and yard waste. So anyway, this plan was developed, it was reviewed, there's a cost estimate of around $600,000 to close the old refuse disposal area and to make these other improvements so the citizens can go in there, dispose of the material and handle it. Getting back to the negotiations with the Levitts, we identified an area. Again, this is the existing transfer station building is right here. We identified the 250-foot buffer line that extends along here that in essence is a 2.7-acre parcel that, or 117,000 square feet, that is involved within this buffer area that we need, to get the letter on in order to do what we need to do in order to satisfy the other DEP's requirements. Anyway, had the meeting in August, again, as I mentioned, with Mr. and Mrs. Levitt. They indicated they'd write the letter. Nothing came of that. Made quite a few phone calls, all of which were in our call accounting system, trying to contact them to to encourage them along, to negotiate with us, to have some sort of discussion. Nothing really came of it. Eventually, a third party known to the council called them this past late this fall, indicated to them that they really needed to talk to us. Eventually, the phone call was made, and we had a meeting with the Levitts on December 26th, again indicating the issue. They indicated they would get back to me. Nothing, again, nothing really came of it. One of the major points in the discussion that involves the Levitts, and I know that some folks here worked on the issue back in the early 1980s, is that the Levitts own 100 acres that's practically landlocked in and around the refuse disposal. As you go in their driveway, there's, I think it's like one parcel, it's about 96 to 100 acres, a little bigger than Fort Williams. Because of the way they have access to that land and some of the town requirements, way, way back, they were given a 20-foot right-of-way over the town property where you see their driveway that extends to their property. If they ever want to subdivide or make any improvements to that property, they really can't do it without expanding that right-of-way in some fashion from 20 feet out to 50 feet. You can't obtain a public access way, you can't have a subdivision unless you have 50 feet within. In the discussions with the Levitts, as indicated in some of the correspondence that's now been made public, is actually offered them in writing an option in exchange, since they apparently weren't willing to give us the letter, of obtaining from them this 2.7 acres in exchange for giving them a 50-foot right-of-way onto their property. This right-of-way, as I mentioned, would make their land more developable than it now is. It would also enhance the value of their land by perhaps several hundred thousand dollars because it's not developable. You know, it was an extremely generous offer on the part of the town in order to accommodate this very necessary municipal project. I sent a letter to the Levitts back on January 16th, indicating that a little bit of the history of it, indicating that we'd had our December 26th meeting, and laying out two options as the town now saw them. One was to grant them a 50-foot right-of-way onto their property, and that in exchange for the right-of-way, the town would deed to them the 250-foot buffer area shown on the plan. And again, they were given a copy of this plan with the 250-foot buffer area. They would then immediately provide the letter to the DEP so that we could go forward with this project. Again, I want to emphasize we're now in violation of state law by having any activity go on that we have going on there now, where people are placing their Christmas trees still, and their metal goods and all that, that is illegal according to the DEP, so we're in violation of law, we need to address that. Indicated to them that that was their first option, that we would give them the right-of-way, they would give us the letter, we would be on with their project, their value of the land would be improved. We had given them something in exchange for helping us to meet this project. And that, you know, that was not done easily. This was only after many, many months of not moving much of anywhere. I realized that, you know, that is not a proposal that citizens would necessarily rise up and applaud, because, you know, there are a lot of people that would like to see that land kept as open space. Option two was pointing out to the Levitts that the project isn't necessarily important to the town, and that if they weren't willing to accept or even consider that very, very generous offer, that we would, that I would come back to the council at this meeting and propose that at the March meeting of the town council, to be an item on the agenda to take this land by eminent domain. That's not the term, is to condemn it for public purposes. In exchange for that, we would give them compensation for that based on an independent appraisal done by a certified review appraiser. In my January 16th letter to the Levitts, I indicated that please let me know by January 29th, 1996, whether or not they wish to move forward with option one, or whether or not they wanted me to move forward with what is going on this evening, which is option two. Did not hear anything from the Levitts except an acknowledgement from Mrs. Levitt on January 17th or 18th, I've got it back in my notes, indicating that she received my letter and she was not at all happy. She didn't feel the options, or the options were reasonable. Anyway, on you know, the deadline was fairly firm, and despite that, other than that one phone call indicating being upset, didn't hear anything. Subsequently, I did send to Mrs. Levitt a letter on February 7th indicating that I hadn't received a response to my January 16th letter, except for the one phone call at which she said she'd be consulting with an attorney, and indicated to her that since I hadn't heard that they were wanted to accept option one, that I was moving forward with option two. Since then, I have spoken with the attorney who Mrs. Levitt apparently, Mr. and Mrs. Levitt apparently have contracted to work with them. Heard from the lawyer for the first time this morning, and he indicated that he had just found out this morning that he was assigned to this, although apparently Mrs. Levitt spoke to someone within the last week, but I should mention apparently after the deadline in the letter. Mrs. Levitt's, you know, indicated all along that she doesn't feel that, you know, the town's been reasonable with her. She was concerned about their method of obtaining an appraisal. You council has some background information on the appraisal. We did discover through the conversation I had with Mrs. Levitt when I called her on the 7th or 8th to let her know that this was becoming public and she could get a call from the press or whatever to just forewarn her. She did voice a very strong objection to the firm we were going to have do the appraisal, because apparently when her property was going through something at some point, Key Bank, who has a mortgage on the property, had gotten that same firm to do an appraisal on the property, and apparently that was shared with Mr. Daigle at some point. Well, we had no knowledge of it, but the fact that the town apparently, or an agent of the town, once saw that appraisal, we immediately I indicated to Mr. Leahy, let's get another appraisal firm, that we can't use one that has any hint that, you know, we might have known what the value was in advance. So anyway, that's about where it stands at this point. I do have an appointment with Jim Katsafikas, who is the attorney who is currently representing the Levitts later this week, and I encouraged Mr. Katsafikas when I spoke to him to review all the correspondence and indicated to him that what my recommendation to the council this evening would be is that which is in your packet, and that is that we really give the Levitts an opportunity until the 27th of this month to really make an offer to the town, to, you know, indicate this evening by you suggesting that you put this off to next month, that, you know, that the town is serious, it needs to deal with this issue, we don't have other options, and to give them one last chance to, you know, make a reasonable offer to the town. I indicated to Mr. Katsifikas that if the council went along with that this evening, that, you know, I was very willing up until the 27th to negotiate, to have discussions, to really have talks with them to see if we can come to some agreement, but that February 27th had to be the end of it. And whatever proposal they had on the table at that point would come to the council with either that proposal or this eminent domain proposal. Because my concern is if we keep letting, you know, even tomorrow the DEP is going to be calling me saying, what happened last night? Their phone calls are becoming more regular, concerned that we haven't followed this deadline. And, you know, we need to have positive, continued planning in place. So anyway, I've really indicated them a willingness for discussion. The one final point I would like to make is, I've worked in the community almost 18 years now, and I've negotiated probably 30 to 40 right-of-way agreements, other areas where the town needed something from a citizen in the form of a legal agreement. In every instance, we've been able to successfully negotiate those without ever coming to the town council with a proposal such as this. This is very much an anomaly, very unusual. That said, I want to say I don't do this lightly. I think this is a crucial project for the town. It needs to move forward. Also would like to mention that, you know, from the viewpoint of the Levitts, the other party in this, you know, we had a lot of discussions early this evening about ball fields, and, you know, people don't want ball fields in certain areas for various reasons. Well, people also don't want staging areas or transfer stations in certain areas, particularly if it's nearby them. And I can certainly understand the Levitts' resistance to wanting the town to in any way change the activity up here. And I would think they would be extremely cautious in terms of working with the town and negotiating with the town, that, you know, they need to protect their property rights as well. And, you know, if the council goes along with the recommendation this evening, which is to give them until February 27 to come up with a proposal, otherwise to let them know that at the March 13th meeting of the council, there will be this proposed condemnation order on the agenda for you to consider. You know, I think that's fair at this point, that we do give them that time, and that is there. So I'd be happy to answer any questions you may have. As I mentioned, I did speak a little earlier, but a little longer than I usually do, but I felt that the public ought to be brought up to date on this issue. Thank you, Madam Chairman.
Thank you. Since we have our town attorney here, there may be members of the council who would like to speak to him. We have the option of going into executive session to discuss different items with him and then coming back out and having our public discussion and public vote. Is there anyone who would wish to go into executive session?
I'd just like to discuss a couple things before we do that, if possible. And I have a couple of questions.
All right.
I'd just like to see where their building envelope is in relation to that. I mean, we've got the dump, but we don't have the Levitts on here.
I don't know where I get where I don't.
How about on views. Mike, could you do it on this one?
This is the, well, let me show here, okay. General. This is the refuse disposal area. Their home is back here. The 250-foot buffer area extends. That's the salt shed right there. That's the salt shed. That's their home. Back here, this is the salt shed.
Okay.
So the area is all fairly much away from their home.
So could you give a clue as to where the house and whatnot would be?
Their house is here. The area involved begins here and is a little sliver right there. The sliver that adds up to 2.7 acres. It follows along here. As you go in the refuse disposal area, Denison Drive, their driveway runs parallel to Denison Drive. You go in, the refuse disposal area then goes like this. Theirs goes straight. We're over in here.
Right. I just wondering if could we make any kind of a stab at where it would be in relation to that, the proposed 250-foot?
This is the 250-foot buffer. Their home is back right about here.
Okay. Great. Thanks.
Is that both your questions?
That's, well, I just have one more thing, I mean, which I'd like to throw out. I'm wondering if, as we consider giving it a little more time, if we might consider a couple of options, or suggest maybe, I just want to think out loud, is, of course, one is the eminent domain option, and the other is for them to provide the letter that we're looking for, and the other is for them to consider the right-of-way. So it seems to me there's three possible options for them, and if there were a motion, if we were voting on something, I'd like to see those three, you know, giving them an opportunity to pick one of the three, basically, and I think that gives them some a couple of options, because if you put a right-of-way there, instantly their property value goes up, and so would their taxes, and they'd almost be obligated to sell off a lot or something, if they, because of the potential there, and so that might be something that they may, I don't know if they want to do that or not. Of those three options, the eminent domain is the only one that would cost the town money. If they wrote a letter, it wouldn't cost the town money. If we traded for a right-of-way, it wouldn't cost the town money. So I think those other options would might benefit them and benefit the town. That's all.
If I might respond, if I might respond to that, by the proposal that's in your packet, giving them until February 27th, you know, allows them to bring forward a proposal that you would consider at your March 13th meeting in lieu of the eminent domain. That gives them the ability to put forward a proposal that would grant them the right-of-way in exchange for this 2.7 acres. It also gives them the ability, as offering their proposal, to simply provide the letter, period, which is what we originally asked for, and that would be it. Those options, you know, under this proposal are open.
Okay. And thank you very much.
Councilor Jordan.
I have a couple of things that I would like to point out that, and there's something that I'd like the manager to look into, and I'm one that hates to take people's property, and I don't mind throwing it right out to start with, and I'll throw out most anything to prevent that. And I know there's one little thing that I think there's a number issue as far as Spunk Avenue for their address, and whether they ever always get their mail at the correct address, I don't know, but there's something, we've got letters here with two different numbers and for addresses, 498 and 478 and what have you. But the part that I'm concerned about is, I don't think the town and we as a town have really looked at this good. I was up there today, and I don't know whether the surveyor's done with their flags and what have you, but I can't find only one good flag. I found one there by the salt chair that was waving with a black plastic bag, and I found another one up in back of the rise there by the Levitt's home. And I would like to know, and I would like to, and you take a map and show me if you wish, but I don't think, I would like to see it on the ground. I'm just a little old fashioned, I guess, or what have you. But I would like to see where the line is and where our road is that goes into the transfer station. That's one. I would like to know if the 250-foot requirement as far as the transfer station is concerned is needed for the road going into the transfer station. I understand it as far as going by the transfer station, down back where the transfer station is. Does the DEP require us to get 250 feet away from that road that goes in there, which has nothing to do with the transfer station until after you swing up on the hill, it heads for the salt shed, and we can get into the salt shed with that road that way. And The other point is, I think the road in there could be moved on town property towards the treatment plant by blowing that nebula off, and you would still wouldn't have, you'd still have a good sight distance from where it goes down over the hill, where that nebula is, and move the road over and into the transfer station.
Michael?
So I don't feel we need the 250 feet all through there to get right up to their back door yard. If that flag that I see today is one for the markers, is right on the knoll there, right by their back windows.
Yep.
Not too far away, and I would like to know that. And I'm not one for pushing people around and taking their property if I don't have to.
Michael?
Nor am I, Councilor Jordan, as you know, I tried to indicate. Let me try to answer, I think, your three questions. One is the proper address, I believe, is 480. I would like to point out that I think the address that was the furthest off, Mrs. Levitt called you the next day indicating that she'd gotten the letter. She called me as well. So it's indisputable the fact that she got the letters.
Well, I understand she got the letter, but it was just a small point that I wanted to point out, that we're not always 100%.
That's true, but people listen on TV, and I don't want them to be getting the impression that we're talking about people not having gotten letters. I think that would be a very unfortunate impression, you know, that's really a side issue here that has nothing to do with, you know, the fact that the DEP could come tomorrow and tell the citizens of Cape Elizabeth, you can't use this facility anymore. They have the power to do that, and I don't take that lightly.
I understand they have the power to do it, but I also understand that we shouldn't push people around just to satisfy the DEP.
Point two, Councilor Jordan, is the road going in has absolutely nothing at all to do with this 250-foot buffer. There is no need at all for us to relocate our road. What we're talking about are the activities that are on top of the hill and the spot where the inert fill is going, the spot where the painted wood is going, and the spot where the leaf composting is proposed to go. It has absolutely nothing to do with the road at all, with one exception. And that's that if we tried to access another area with another road going into there, you know, so that we weren't working down across the back, say we put it way over on the other side of the hill, we'd get into a situation where we would need to have another full-time person on that site, because you have to, under the DEP rules, have all of the areas being watched over, protected, access ensured. Even to get people down there, part of this proposal is to have a security gate so that people can't get down in there without being let down in. That avoids you getting hazardous waste and other things left on site. We can't somehow put another road in coming off Spurwink Avenue without having an additional full-time person. So that has very long-term cost impacts, and there's still very limited land over there in order to be able to do anything, particularly with the wetland down below. The third point you mentioned about, you know, the flags and where is it. One of the difficulties with this is that the Levitts have not given us permission for us to go under their land in order to do any of this surveying. In order to do that, they would have to either give us written permission, or they would need to, we would need to go to court to get that permission. I would like to point out, however, that we discovered after the surveys began that they had in fact been on some of her property, and they had been counseled by the town attorney to the engineer, me to the engineer, that they were not to do that. Unfortunately, they did go on the property at one point in time, but that's why you don't see more flags out there. But I want to, you know, this is not in at all, near their home at all. You know, I you know, be glad to go out with you on site any time if you give me a call. It's way down beyond the salt shed, and when it gets to the salt shed, it goes in a beeline down towards the high school as you look at that. It doesn't go back towards the house at all.
So it doesn't come up to the road that goes into their house?
That's right.
Let me go back here again.
It don't?
Do you want to come down and look at it?
No, I'll listen to you so the people can hear what's going on.
Their home is here.
Yeah.
This Here is the salt shed.
Yeah.
That's the entrance to the dump road, Denison Drive. That's their right-of-way going in. But this is the salt shed. This is their home. This area that we're talking about, okay, this is the salt shed here. You go down beyond the salt shed to this point. It begins here. It goes along that lower road below the transfer station, way down and back there. A small sliver here for, what's the scale on this one? 1 inch equals 50. So you get about 300 feet down here before it begins to widen out. So you're down in, you're talking about down in here when their home is back here.
So what you're saying, you're not taking, and you're not after any land from the salt shed, just below the salt shed towards the marsh?
That's correct. This?
So those flags that's up above there mean nothing, is that correct?
Excuse me?
Those flags above there from the salt sheds towards...
What they did is they put two flags on that slab there, and those are just the control points that they're using in the surveying.
I'd like to meet you out there sometime.
I'd be happy to.
Would anyone like to go into executive session for discussion with our town attorney?
Unless he's got something else shaking, I'm...
Would you, do you have any questions of our town attorney since he's been sitting here for...
Any question that I have, I just, it's going to be posed to the manager.
Anyone else? Tom, do you want to make a statement to give us some guidance to make sure we proceed correctly?
Thank
which
Madam
you already
Chairman.
Have in writing, but nevertheless.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. As Mr. McGovern indicated, we have moved on to another appraiser who indicated today he would accept the assignment. He has worked with the State Claims Commission for two terms, I think 4 years each, so he's had 8 years with condemnation cases with the state, and he's a independent fee appraiser who has had nothing to do with the property before. The recommendation of Mr. McGovern, I just want to make clear, if it's a two-track recommendation that he be authorized to accept a proposal, and I say accept to bring to you on March 13th, that would be one track, and the second track would be to be prepared for March 13th to have an order before you that I would prepare, meeting the statutory requirements to take the 2.7 acres and pay just compensation for that. That would require, however, that we have a meets and bounds legal description, which has been ordered and should be due now from Wright Pierce. That's part of their project. This plan that you have up here does not have a meets and bounds description, just a showing of the line. And that is required by statute. Secondly, you would have to be prepared at the time you approve the order to set the damages, to set the amount that you find, presumably based upon the appraisal you would have in your hand, what the damages would be payable to the Levitts. The procedure would be to tender that amount. So for your deliberations, my legal work is essentially done. We've determined the record owners, the mortgagee, the meets and bounds description's been ordered, an appraiser has been retained. What I need to present this to you on March 13th would be the authority to take the steps necessary to prepare the order, which include, I would say, maybe up to $2,500 for an appraisal. The appraisal would have to obviously withstand scrutiny. You'd want it to be a good appraisal. It has to appraise the property before and appraise it after with the taking, and they would have to give consideration to any impact upon the remaining site if this piece were taken by the town. So it's not just what this piece is worth, but whether or not it impacts the rest of the site. Beyond that, I don't know what I can add. I have spent some time reviewing the access issues and the prior plans. Answer any questions now or in executive session, whatever the preference would be of any council members.
Council Lanell.
I have a question or two, and if it has to be answered, if it's better answered in executive session, you know, I'm sure you'll let me know. In terms of the having the appraisal done, What would be a likely timeframe, in other words, for that to happen, and would, for example, the minute it's done, would, you know, the council and the Levitts be privy to that amount? I mean, I think, I'm just thinking it might be useful to them to know, you know, what we'd give them for it, so to speak, if they're trying to make up their minds, and how many days would they have to sort of chew on it before?
Yes, the answer is that for a full appraisal of this property, you're probably talking 30 days. You're going right up to your March meeting. I believe I could have it before the March meeting. I would ask for it to be a week before the March meeting, and I think they can live with that, but that's tight. They like 30 days for these sorts of appraisals. Now, as to delivery of this, just as I don't always recommend you go in executive session, I have no problem. They were already advised of who the first appraiser would be, and I could tell them who the chosen appraiser would be now. I don't have any problem. They're going to know it. They're going to know what we propose for damages. With your permission, we can let them have that appraisal when it's available.
Well, I'd like to do that. And I guess my concern is if we only give them till the 27th to make up their minds, but the appraisal isn't available for a month or something, it's pretty awkward for them to make up their minds.
Well, I understand the choices. Up to date, it hasn't been an issue of the money. It's been their consideration whether they want to simply give a letter with nothing more, or whether they want to consider the grant of the 50-foot easement from Spurwink Road to their property. That, Mr. McGovern has said, would enhance the property by a substantial amount. I don't think there's any question whatsoever that it would enhance the property and probably be a lot more than the appraisal of 2.7 acres of land in the back. So I think that offer is a very generous offer. I think you can anticipate that offer would be more than 2.7 acres would appraise for. I'm not an appraiser, but I think it's quite evident. The property may not be developable without a 50-foot access. It is not developable without 50-foot access.
Highest and best use.
The appraisal is being done as the highest and best use.
Correct.
So even though there are wetlands there, it's still considered to be good buildable land.
Well, it's the highest and best use of the whole tract, and then they would make an accommodation for what piece this is.
Okay. Did you want to say something, Michael? May I have a motion, please? We can discuss it.
Could we go into executive session for a minute? I have a question I'd like to ask. Any other, no interest?
Are you going? Well, you can make the motion, see if it's second.
I'll see what happens.
You're moving that we go into executive session to consult with our lawyer on a land matter?
Yes.
On your legal rights in regard to this?
Yes.
Is there a second? Okay, I guess we do not.
Madam Chairman,
McLaughlin.
I recommend that we authorize the town manager to work with the town attorney to take all necessary steps to prepare a draft condemnation order for our March 13th, 1996 agenda, and to also authorize the manager to accept a single non-negotiable offer from the Levitts that must be delivered to the town by 4 o'clock on Wednesday. Is that a Wednesday? 4 o'clock on February 27th, 1996.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Just a clarification on the terminology used there as accept. To receive?
To receive.
Perhaps.
To receive? I was trying.
Is that what you'd be doing?
I meant to receive.
You can tentatively accept for our approval?
And then I forward it on to you. It's accept as, you know, I have no legal right to accept anything unless you've authorized me. You know, you're not doing
clear, that's
right. To receive.
Yeah. And I do want to make absolutely clear that prior to February 27th, if the other party is willing, we will have whatever discussions with them that they choose to have. Yeah. But once after, the reason we need a set date is, you know, I think because we really need to know where we're going with this so that we can satisfy the DEP, and so that, you know, it's really, what I don't want is them coming to the March 13th meeting and beginning to offer new proposals, you know, at that meeting. I don't think that's constructive, and it's certainly not in the best interests of good public policy.
Thank you. Councilor Jordan.
So I understand that they have an attorney now?
They do. Very competent attorney.
And you have been in contact with him?
Spoke with him today and have an appointment with him later in the week.
So you feel that it can move forward then?
I, you know, it depends on if the party agrees, you know, to something. I don't know. I can't speak for the other party, Bill.
I'm not asking you to speak for the other party. I'm just asking you, felt the attorney was a type of person who would like to move the things forward or to drag them out.
The attorney is very good, professional, and competent, but, you know, Mr. Leahy is too, and still he only gives advice to you when you can choose to ignore it, and I, you know, whatever the other attorney, you know, ultimately it's up to his client. But the attorney, both attorneys involved in it are very good, capable people.
Mr. Jordan, I did speak to both of those attorneys today, and they're both looking forward to meeting, and they think this should be resolved. It's the right way to resolve by negotiation, and they're looking forward to sitting down. They gave me every indication that they wanted to do that, and time will tell. But I think we could hopefully come to you with something that's in writing and clear for you to respond to at your meeting.
Well, that's what I want. I think we're, you know, giving a little more time here than what was originally proposed, and I just want to get the feeling that it isn't going to be a type of a deal where somebody makes a call and they never call me back, and here we go again. But you feel they're the type of people that will work straight forward on it.
I feel so, and I just wanted to add that I had spoken to him as well as Mr. McGovern. I think we got the same impression from both communications.
Okay.
Any other discussion? If not, all those in favor of authorizing the manager to commence the process as presented?
To be presented at the March 13th meeting?
Right. I'm not going to repeat her whole motion. We know about for the March 13th meeting, and it has to be received by February 27th.
I'll second it.
Okay, all those in favor? It's 7-0 to begin the process. Thank you, Mr. Leahy. Item number 105, to consider establishing the proposed, I hope we'll change the name, Core Farm Study Committee and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yes. Thank you, Madam Chairman. This committee also structure was reviewed by the town council at a workshop. Was that also on the 22nd or the 29th? I get confused.
29th. Yeah.
On the workshop on the 29th. What this is about is that several years ago, the town acquired the interests of the Thomas Jordan Trust in what was the Poor Farm and also the refuse disposal area. Over the years, we've had a number of proposals on how the non-refuse disposal area portion of this property ought to be used. We've had discussions with the Rachel Carson Wildlife Refuge through the, what's that department, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. We've had talk about putting ball fields as recently as this evening on the property. There was a proposal many years ago to put a mental health hospital on the property. I remember that hearing very, very well. If you want to see a contentious hearing, that was a contentious hearing. There have been proposals to place conservation restrictions on the land. It was once the proposed site for our sewer treatment plant, until someone said, why don't you move the thing across the road? Why does it need to be out there in the open? We've had people farm it. Right now, we have an agreement with a gentleman down on Scott Dyrod who hays it for us, and you might have noticed how well cut it is now. That's because we have a citizen who, in exchange for the haying rights, keeps it cleared for us. So anyway, all these things have come up, and there was the suggestion back when the Thomas Jordan issue was resolved, now that we've resolved what we're doing with the money and we're buying the interest and we're setting up the trust and how that works, that leaves unanswered what's going to happen with the land. So in discussions with some interested citizens in the community and with the council chairman, it was suggested we set up a committee. There was a draft charge earlier that's been changed somewhat based on the discussion at your workshop. As it now stands, it'd be a five-member committee consisting of a council member appointed by the council chair, the Conservation Commission and Land Trust would each have two members to serve on the committee.
I would serve as a non-voting ex officio member. The purpose of the committee would be to discuss the status of the property, excluding that part that's used as the refuse disposal area, and to make any recommendations relating to the property the committee believes is in the best interest of the community. During its deliberations, the committee shall conduct a public forum to solicit community input and shall keep the council and public informed of its work. Committee shall also review all the files and all the appropriate documents. And this would cost some money. We have a comprehensive plan implementation account which has $1,492 in it, and I'm recommending $1,500 be taken from that account, which will put it $8 in the hole, for the preparation of maps and related work. And the sense is that it might take about another $500 to finish the work, and that would be come out of next year's budget in the next fiscal year. We're looking at about a $2,000 effort. The committee would report back to the council no later than the end of this year after holding its public forum and its other outreach activities.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. Is there a motion on formation of this? May I recommend that we change, pardon?
That's all we're after right now is a formation of it, not a
We're authorizing the money.
The money and the formation of it.
That's right.
Not the bodies.
I have some bodies. I don't have them all. I haven't heard back from a committee yet.
So is that a separate vote when we get
to
the bodies?
That's an appointment by the chair of the council. What we're asked to approve tonight is the formation of the proposal that's before you, the formation of the committee, and the funds to do the work.
So the council has no part in the appointments, just the council chair.
That's right. Which is the way it was decided at our workshop. Councilor Reed.
That's not quite right.
Excuse me.
No.
What?
What this charge has is that the council member would be appointed by the chair. The Conservation Commission members and the Land Trust members, they would designate their own two. They wouldn't be appointments of the council chair. So four of the committee members would be two designees of the Land Trust, two designees of the Conservation Commission. The only say the council chairman has is the appointment of a council member under this draft.
How about the two citizens?
There are no, the citizens would be members either of the Land Trust or the Conservation Commission.
Okay.
We had a long discussion that night on the composition of the committee, and we ended up with this final composition. What I would like to see, though, is that we change the name of the committee. We could, please.
What I would like to see that we change how the appointments are made here.
Why?
Because I don't think that it should be loaded with conservation and members. I know we discussed of two, and they were sitting right there, and they're sitting down there now, and I can eye them right from here without my glasses, and I thought it was to be one from each and two citizens.
No, the final consensus that night, after the original proposal had two council members, a member of the planning board, a member from each of these other two groups, and after much discussion and deciding that people were being overworked and we were asking for too many volunteers, that we would reduce it to one council member and ask for two from each of these other bodies.
Well, I guess I took a nap, and I'll speak to my father tomorrow, Father Chappell.
Councilor Reed.
Madam Chair, since I serve on the P2 committee, I'm looking at the name of this. I suggest you make it the F2P2 committee. But anyway, regardless of the name, I do want you to know I'm going to continue not to support this formation of this committee at this time. I do think that the effort would be valuable. I'm just concerned that right now we have ZORC, which is an ongoing process, the P2 committee, which is ongoing, the Municipal Facilities Committee, which is going to be changed most probably in the near future to a building committee, a pool study committee, and a school support delivery option committee. And my concern is, I heard in earlier agenda items a reference to a 20-year-old report, a 10-year-old report, and I feel that the reports are very valuable. I also think they should have a purpose. Right now, with the exception of one speaker tonight who wanted this studied for a baseball field, arguably this could be given as a reason why this committee was formed, and I would hate to have that suggestion, unless, of course, it's true. My other concern is that, not that I believe in denial, but I think that when this committee does report back with recommendations, and it does point out certain things that need to be done, it is incumbent upon us to act. And my concern, again, is that we have a lot of issues, many that have been studied for a very long time that have not come to closure, and I suggest that I will not support this until some of those other issues are ended. Thank you.
Councilor Lanau.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I think the spirit of this is good. I mean, sooner, before too much time goes by, I think it's a worthy thing to look at. However, I do think the timing is tough, and is tough. And for example, with all the other activity going on, and I would like to see two councilors on it. And so I guess I would tend to favor putting it off for a few months. I guess perhaps we could talk a little more about the makeup as to make sure we come up with the right number, because if we just put another counselor on, we'd have six people, and we generally like to have an odd number. So
Michael can be the odd one. He's not voting.
He's not voting, though. So
changed.
I mean, I think it's again, I just think it's and I know there's some people here that are concerned about it, and I think that this is something that we really should. It is a tremendous asset, if you will, of the town, and we need to be very careful with it. But I do want to. I think that it would be better if we just sort of held our horses for a few months and looked at it a little later. That's all.
Councilor Bill.
Councilor Bill, it's getting late. I kind of disagree with Councilor Lanau on this one. I like to take the other side once in a while, and I think we have Dewey and Beaver sitting in the back of the room, and they don't really have too much to do. And I think we could find people enough that's not too busy that would like to serve on something like this. So I think we ought to move forward with that.
I think that we also should consider that this is the third part of a long process that began in 1988 when we formed the first Thomas Jordan Trust Study Committee, and then it went on to the committee that just dealt with how the money and the trust money should be invested and spent. And the third was what should be recommended for the land. And I think since 1988, and it's now 1996, that we should just keep things rolling. And since we have not had a drought in people willing to serve in this committee, and if they feel they have the time, I think that we should get it done now instead of just putting it off and letting it collect dust and try to remember to do it in another year or so. I think this council has a tendency to overanalyze and stall some issues that really basically are quite simple. So may I is there a motion on this particular item?
I would like to make another comment. I would like to serve on it. I have no problem that way, but I would probably get accused of a conflict of interest because one of my ancestors way, way back was the owner of that property, so I wouldn't want that to run around town, so I will withdraw for any part of being on that committee.
May I have a motion, please, on this item?
I'll make one.
Where is it? Where is
it? You've got to listen.
I'm listening.
Madam Chairman, I move that we do not establish the former Poor Farm Property Study Committee, or its successor named, at this time.
Second. Well, I'll just reiterate all my reasons for continuing on a forward mode instead of spinning our wheels again for forming the committee. I don't know if there's anyone else who wants to make a comment. John?
I'll comment. I agree with what both Bill and Rosemary said. I think we're over-committed. That's a word right now. I don't see any need to put this on the front burner right now. With all due respect to the people from the Conservation Commission and the Land Trust, I mean, we need to allay their fears. Nothing's going to happen with this property until we take a real close look at it. And, you know, I think there's time. There's no need to do it this particular time.
Move the motion.
All those in favor of not forming this committee? All those opposed? So the committee is not formed.
Yet.
And we will
have.
Yet.
Thank you, Land Trust Committee and Conservation Committee, for coming forward with your nominees. Next time, I guess we'll just have.
Could it come out 4-3?
Yeah.
4-3.
To consider number item 106, approving the warrant for March 5th, 1996, presidential primary, and take any necessary action.
So moved.
Second.
I would like to refer to our town clerk, please.
Just a couple things, if I could.
Thank you.
We are requesting this tonight that you sign the first presidential preference primary election warrant. The election will be held on Tuesday, March 6th at the high school gymnasium. The polls will be open from 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. Anyone that wishes to register to vote may do so at Town Hall. Please remember that the Democrats and Republicans will be participating in this primary, that you must be enrolled in either of those parties to participate in their party primary. If you are currently enrolled and wish to change your enrollment, there is a deadline, which is this Friday, which is February 16th. If you are registered to vote but unenrolled, you may declare a party anytime up and including the day of the election. So I just did want to mention that date since it is coming up quickly. The warrant also states that the clerk shall begin processing absentee ballots each hour beginning at 7 a.m. through 8 p.m. on Election Day, March 5th. So again, I would ask that you sign the election warrant.
Thank you. Any discussion? All those in favor of approving the warrant, the 7-0 vote. Next item, citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda.
Speak up.
There being no one, we will move on to item number 107, to consider entering into executive session to continue the annual evaluation of the town manager.
I move the table.
I think it's a very unfair from my standpoint at 10:30 at night to go into executive session. I don't think it's fair to anyone, including the manager.
I agree.
Second.
Amen.
So moved.
Madam Chairman, I move we adjourn.
Second.
Third.
All in favor?
Fifth.
And we will have to schedule another public meeting, an executive session, so that we can give Michael a fair evaluation.
Just one brief mention. Following the meeting, after the mic's gone off, the council will be discussing very briefly the date of your next workshop meeting. And if anyone at home wishes to know when that is going to be in the agenda, we should know within the next few days.
Do you want my red, my purple?
Good night, everyone. Thanks for being here.